Thank you, Mauricio. Thank you, Catherine, for the invitation. I have no conflicts of interest, and in the next few minutes, I will share with you what we have done so far in the study of the temporal dynamics of the stress neuroconnectum. I think this will illustrate in a complementary way what Mauricio has shown us. If you remember, the key questions that Ansel Lee has posed on the stress research that Mauricio just shared with us are actually illustrated here in this working model that we are trying to elucidate. So obviously, it's the response to stress that we use to measure stress, and obviously there's a lot of modulating factors that actually modify this response. One of the key questions, as has been previously highlighted, is whether an individual is susceptible to that exposure and whether we could discriminate the vulnerable ones in contrast with the resistant one. And then the next question is whether we can understand what is being changed within the brain networks, and whether this new pattern will be self-sufficient to maintain the stress status and eventually the pathology, or whether we can recover from that status. I will share with you recent data from the lab that actually helps to answer some of these questions, but obviously many more are there to be solved. So I obviously will talk about chronic stress, chronic unpredictable stress, but I always love to say that stress is fantastic. If there was not stress, we would not be alive. Because people tend to believe that stress is always bad. That's not the case. It's actually the opposite. But in certain conditions, it might drive pathology. And I will start this talk on systems neuroscience to describe the impact of stress on instrumental behavior. To make it really simple, instrumental behavior is the association between an action and an outcome. And this can be done in two completely different ways. One is the goal-directed behaviors. So I do something because I want to do something, I want to have that reward, or because I'm habitual. As an example, I like to tell you that I drive every day from my home to my workplace. I go from south to north in Portugal. Okay? When I start to do that, I was focusing on the way to get to university. And I could not release my brain to other things, but I was doing something on a goal-directed circuit. With time, as you can believe, it's the car that actually takes me there. And I can release my brain to other things. In the brain, this means that we have transferred the action from this associative network, this cortical striatal thalamic circuit, to this other network. Okay? And we know by previous studies from our labs and other labs that the prefrontal cortex is impacted by stress. So the first question we had was whether there would be an impact on the way we do decision making in instrumental behavior after exposure to stress. And to do that, we decided to study these circuits. First thing we did was to see what was going on at the level of the structure of the sensorimotor cortex, and nothing changed. Then we decided to study the dorsal striatum, which has two divisions, the associative striatum that belongs to the goal-directed behavior network, and the sensorimotor dorsal striatum that is activated when we are habitual. Okay? In rodents, this will be called dorsal medium striatum, and in humans, caudates, whereas the sensorimotor striatum is dorsal lateral striatum in rodents and putamen in humans. When we did this study in rodents, we could find that the volume of the dorsal medial striatum was reduced, whereas the volume of the dorsal lateral striatum was increased in stressed animals. And this was due to a reshape of the dendritic arborization in medium spiny neurons. What we did then was to do instrumental behavior task. So animals were food deprived and they learned to associate food with a particular lever. And then they had to change the rate of success of getting the reward, and they became habitual after a while. We decided to get to know whether they made their decisions based on goal-directed behavior or on habits by doing a devaluation. Pretty simple experiment. You give animals access to food before they have to go to the lever-pressing paradigm. And when we did that early during stress exposure, what we could see is that both controls and stress, rats and mice here, could actually devalue it. So in other words, both groups were goal-directed. They did understand that they had the reward, so they don't have to work more to get more reward. When we did the same paradigm after chronic stress exposure, we could see that controls could easily devaluate it, so they were goal-directed, whereas stressed animals could not. So in other words, we could see a shifting pattern in the decision-making paradigm after chronic stress in rodents. Then what we did was to study the function of the circuit, and we implemented several electrodes in vivo freely moving electrophysiological paradigm, and we could see the spikes of medial prefrontal cortex, dorsal medial striatum, and dorsal lateral neurons. And as you can see here during time, what we could observe was that there was a dramatic change in the pattern of spiking in the dorsal medial striatum, whereas other regions seem to be pretty stable. When we did the study of the coherence between the spikes in between medial prefrontal cortex and dorsal medial striatum, what we see with time was a decrease in the coherence of the activation of this link in stressed animals, which actually explains the deficit in transferring back from habitual circuits to goal-directed behavior. So the next level of experiments was, can we reverse that? And so what we did is, this is the perfect place to do an optogenetic approach, and that's what we did. So we created a cassette in which we had channel rhodopsin in the link between the prefrontal cortex, prelimbic, and dorsal medial striatum. And after stimulation at 4 Hz, we could actually revert this phenotype, and we could revert the deficit in decision-making that we were observing in rodents. At a certain point, people start to ask us, okay, this proves that you can actually do this in rodents, but can you do the same in humans? So we decided to do a translational study by studying individuals that have high levels of stress. And they had to do this very simple paradigm in which they had the reward within the scanner if they had a right answer in a probabilistic task that was pretty easy. As you can see, stress and controls can easily learn the task, and they get the reward, in this case, a chocolate shoes, if they give the right answer. We then decided to compare high and low probability responses, and as you can see, the area that gets popped up in the ball signal is area 9 of Brodmann, which is a perfect internal control. When we contrasted the results of the last block and the first block, where people actually know the answer, we could see that the areas that got activated were medial prefrontal cortex and caudate, which are exactly the areas that represent the associative network. So these individuals were actually pressing the right button because they wanted to get chocolate. They had a perfectly goal-directed behavior. So then we decided to do the same experiment and test them on a devaluation task. So we took them out of the scanner and gave them as much chocolate as they could eat. A very expensive experiment, I might say. When they said to us that they could not see chocolate anymore, they got back to the scanner and they did the same. And as you can see here, control individuals actually could devalue, whereas stressed individuals could not. And proving that there was a shift in the networks that were being activated, controls activated more than stressed the caudate, whereas stressed individuals activate more than controls the putamen. Now we decided to bring back these LC individuals after the end of the stress exposure. So these are the same individuals after 6 weeks of the end of the stimulus that was creating stress to them. And they did exactly the same study. And as you can see now, they could evaluate again, and the activation of the caudate came back. The same type of results could be seen in contingency degradation, which is another internal control of this experiment. We also did some structural volumetric studies in these particular cortical striatal networks in these individuals. And you can see that we could replicate precisely the data that we observe in rodents. So you have areas that increase the volume after stress, such as the putamen or the orbital frontal cortex, and areas that got smaller, such as the caudate and medial prefrontal cortex. The relevant thing is that when I turn to the next slide, you will see the opposite map, which represents the same individuals after recovery from stress, which means that these cortical striatal networks in these experimental conditions actually display fantastic plastic properties. So we then decided to move to another level. And because we now can use systems neuroimaging and combine this to actually get the image of the functional and the structural connectome, we decided to do that by merging segregation and integration in a network modeling that comprises several steps that ends up by using a graph theory in a functional atlas which displays in the rodent, particularly in the rat, 60 areas of functional interest. Then we apply network-based statistics and we can study the connectome. So, first thing we did was to study this. So these animals were scanned several times throughout the exposure to stress. And the first thing we saw was that we could see the areas in the brain that display the alterations in the structure. And the first was this area in the ventral hippocampus and in the amygdala. But as you can see, after 3 weeks, there's a spread of alterations, of structural alterations, to many different areas of the brain. Then we decided to study the functional connectome of stressed animals versus control animals. And as you can see here, we can display networks in which stressed animals at rest do display a higher level of connectivity, as you can see in these graphs. These networks are both closed networks and long distant networks. We were pretty excited with these findings, but then we decided to do something that Mauricio has already explained to you, that if we combine, not all animals actually display the same type of response to stress. So what if we merge this in a cluster analysis with behavioral data, with endocrine data, with molecular data, and create different types of animals within the stress group, those who are low responders and those who are high responders. And this is the approach we had. Fortunately, David has already explained to you the elevated plasmase. So we had this approach, and we came back to study the structural connectome, and now we can see the midline changes in the white matter fiber tracking that actually stressed animals had an increase in this structural connectivity. And we can now see a completely different picture of the functional connectome between the animals that are vulnerable and those that are resilient to stress using exactly the same strategy. As you can see now, the cloud of blue points and the cloud of red points is really well segregated at this moment. So now we actually know what are the changes that stress triggers in the brain, and we can even discriminate in between vulnerable and resistant animals. So we actually then start to pose new questions. And these new questions actually include really interesting stuff that you can do if you do a longitudinal approach. And the first one that we were asked is, when can you start to see the changes that you just showed us? And we can start to see those changes after 1 week of stress, actually after 3 days of stress. And you can even see that there is a reverse in the networks. So at the very acute phase, it's much more subcortical networks that are being changed. And then there's a transfer to subcortical to cortical changes. The next question, which is really the most exciting question to me, is whether we can predict this type of response. And here we could use a retrospective approach. So we knew now the results, and we went back to the original data at moment zero, at day three, at day seven, and we now segregate the functional connectome based on that. And as you can see here, there's a network that pops up with approximately 13 nodes. And the links between these nodes seem to be very important, and as you can see, it's very well discriminated, and it seems to be changed in a more short-term dynamics than in a long-term dynamics. So now let's go back to humans, and can we see this in humans? So this is data on resting state network analysis in humans, and what you are seeing here is the activation of the default mode network in control individuals and in stress individuals, and as you can see, there's a difference in the activation of this default network in favor of a greater activation in stress. So actually, corresponding to the same type of data that I've just showed you in rodents. What is also impressive is that there is a partial recovery of the activation pattern of the default mode network when these individuals recover from stress. Obviously, now we can apply this to many different conditions, and we can actually study networks that increase connectivity and networks that decrease connectivity, in which education seems to impact very importantly. Here you can see what is going on in the recovery of stress from these humans, these individuals, and these are very interesting nodes that we are certainly exploring from different perspectives. Things are always more complex than they seem. And in life, there's not only a single factor that is modulating the structure of brain networks. And this is a first approach to show you, actually a study published this year, not in 96 years, to try to figure out what are the covariances between factors. So if stress does this, what does age do at the same time, and what does mood do? And this is a very complex analysis, but I think it's the way for us at labs and in the clinics to actually try to understand what is going on in the brain of our patients. The other important messages from this type of works is that it's not only the activation pattern that is important, but also the deactivation pattern of these networks that actually is very interesting for an analysis. I'm afraid that I will now disappoint you when I show you this video. So this is the type of work that we currently do. But those of you who study brain networks using fMRI will know that we have we face lots of different obstacles that are really tough to be solved. And this is just one. The dynamics, the critical dynamics, as Mauricio showed in the spines, things change in minutes. What I will show you now is a video that illustrates some seconds of a subject, an healthy subject, that is within the scan, and we just told them, please close your eyes and try to think about nothing. And you will see what happens. So, as you can see in the video, This is the entire brain network, and as you can see, it's constantly changing at the scale of seconds or subseconds. So in other words, when I'm presenting the resting state data, I'm presenting to you an average. And probably that's why the correlation between the data that we are using with resting state networks and the clinics is so low, because it's the dynamic of this network that interests us. So we did a clustering approach, and we came up with an idea that there's different functional states, and it's the shift from one state to the other that actually is critical to correlate with the behavioral data, with the neuropsychological data, as we can see here in a study using LC-aged subjects and trying to do this type of correlation using neurocognitive approaches. So I'm sorry to have disappointed you at the end, but I think these are very exciting days for us to try to understand the dynamics of the brain, and hopefully we can all do this together. I have to thank all the team in Braga that does this. By the way, because there might be Portuguese here, the university is Minho. And if you say Braga, some people will get really annoyed. So it's Minho, north part of Portugal. The funding is there. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks very much, Nuno, for this quite stimulating presentation. And we have time for a couple of questions, because I think there is a session just in 10 minutes, so we have limited time.
Just one question. So how I understand is so very excited data on the resting state, but more interesting not only resting state, but a response of stressed brain or non-stressed brain on the proceeding of the task. Could you say, please, maybe you done this experiment, maybe you analyze difference stressed brain, non-stressed brain on proceeding on the task, on the perception, on information, on the emotional information, on, for example, for the people proceeding on the special task, mathematical, other types of...
Right. No.
Because it really exists difference, functional connectivity in the people on the...
Sure.
Stressed or unstressed?
Absolutely. That probably is important for when we are analyzing the dynamics in resting state networks, but obviously is less important when you are using a single moment block design, you know, single shot, because that really is that moment in time that you are trying to correlate, even though you have to take into account that there is a delay between the shift in the activation in the brain and the ball signal. But obviously, that's part of stress. So what I'm trying to say to you is that that is part of what we are trying to study. Obviously, it's very complex to do these studies. It's even more complex when we have to take into account those dynamics. But I think if we don't, we will never understand what is going on at the levels of the connector.
Quick question. Great talk, Nuno. As a pharmacologist, my question would be, how drugs alter that?
Plenty. Someone has to invite me in the next years. What we are trying to do now is trying to figure out, now that we know the nodes and the networks that are impacted, some of those nodes and networks are, for instance, between the locus coeruleus and thalamic and medial prefrontal cortex areas. Others are from the area of the raphe, or where the raphe is, because we do also have problems with discrimination at the level of MR studies. But actually, because now we know that, we can intervene based on evidence, on the changes. And we actually tend to believe that there's also a temporal dynamics that has to be incorporated in the pharmacological approaches, but also in other stimulation approaches that we have to do.
But you think it's a matter of shrinking the time that will be necessary to this shift? Or some nodes are more important than other nodes?
I didn't have time to discriminate entire networks that were being changed, but some of the nodes, as you probably noticed, were always popping up and they had more connections to other points. So this is what we understand as hubs, and those are probably the critical nodes for the shifts. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Nuno, and I think we have to free